Thank you. It's great to be with you today. Thank you for spending your lunchtime hour with me. Today we're going to talk about a topic that's kind of at the intersection of, you could think, health economics and finance. Right, so I'm a finance professor originally. I'm an economist, a macroeconomist. So it's kind of curious that I arrived at this topic. This is partially driven by kind of a personal experience. Like so many, you know, in our families, we're struggling with the incidence of cancer. It's also partially just driven by the fact that this is a really interesting and exciting economics problem. And so I'd like to tell you a little bit more about it. So the picture you're looking at is a cancer cell, which is the pink cell. And these blue cells are T cells. And these T cells are supposed to attack the cancer cell and basically neutralize it. Now, it turns out that the immune system that we all have is kind of geared to protect us against attackers. And so the immune system turns out to shut down the attacks of these blue cells, which are supposed to attack the cancer cell. It shuts that down. And so as a result, this cancer cell can proliferate and grow and kind of develop into the kind of you know, horrible disease that we know cancer to be. Now, there's been amazing recent progress in the medical literature, in the medical field. And in fact, just less than a month ago, the Nobel Prize in medicine, physiology, was awarded to two researchers, one from UT Austin, or actually UT Houston, one from Kyoto, who came up with a solution to this problem that I just described. And so in particular, they kind of discovered these proteins, which are known as CTLA-4 and PD-1, which suppress the immune system's response to these cancer cell attacks. And so they figured out a way to stop this. So normally we'd like the immune system to be very active, and so we have some diseases where we'd like the immune system to fight harder. Here's a situation where we'd like the immune system to fight less hard, right? And so these guys figured out a way of turning off this kind of response. And so once you turn off these responses, now the T cells can do their job and attack the cancer cell. And so this was a breakthrough idea, so much so that they got the Nobel Prize. But kind of beyond the Nobel Prize, this has been an invention that has already saved thousands, if not tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of lives in the world. It turns out that this was just kind of the beginning of what I think of as a medical revolution. And if I think of science today, probably the most exciting part of all of science is medical science. And this is probably the most exciting part of medical science. This line of attack, this kind of line of therapies, which are commonly known as immunotherapies. Okay? And so what I've given you is just kind of two examples of a broader group of kind of medical treatments that are very effective at fighting cancer. And you know, some of you might have heard about, for example, melanoma. Right? The former president of the United States had melanoma, received his immunotherapy treatments, and Jimmy Carter, and is alive and well today. But it turns out that these therapies, you know, work far beyond melanoma. In fact, they work for, you know, dozens of different cancer sites, which are kind of different parts of the body where cancer develops. And there's now, you know, something like 30 or 40 drugs that have already been approved by the Federal Drug Administration, the FDA, and that are kind of basically currently prescribed. And so you can see the names of these drugs here in the little cells. They usually end with MOP or with NIB, and so they're basically all different immunotherapy agents. Now, one interesting thing about these drugs is that until recently, and in fact in many of these cases still today, they're being used as a second line of treatment, which means that if you have cancer, the typical first line of treatment would be you get chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and only if that fails will they prescribe this immunotherapy, right? But the problem with chemo and radiotherapy is that they're very destructive. They are destroying the healthy cells as well as the cancer cells. And so they're very bad for the body. And if the cancer were to return, you know, there's only so many times you can go through this. In contrast, these immunotherapies are very favorable. They don't attack the bad cells. And so in principle, you could have these kind of therapies done repeatedly without much damage to the body. So increasingly, these therapies are being prescribed as first-line therapies instead of chemotherapy and radiotherapy, which is an exciting development. So there's currently the pharmaceutical companies. We're in a business school. This is big business. For Merck, which is probably the largest pharmaceutical company in the world,
The number two selling drug is one of these immunotherapies. They're selling $5 billion worth of that one drug. It's called Keytruda. Keytruda sells $5 billion every year. Okay, so this is big business. And if you think about the pipeline of new drugs and new R&D development that pharmaceutical companies are doing, the bulk of it, at least like, you know, 40% of it is in immunotherapies. Okay, so this is kind of a very important kind of part of their R&D spending as well. Now, what's so exciting about these new developments is that they've, I mean, obviously we wouldn't be thinking or talking so much about it, that they've led to durable gains in survival. Okay, so now how do we establish durable gains in survival? Well, typically what happens is, you know, some medical professor or some researcher at a pharmaceutical company will run what's called a clinical research trial. And so they'll basically take a group of patients that have kind of the same disease, let's say stage 3 melanoma, and they'll split them into two halves. One half gets allocated to the what's called the treatment arm, and these people will be given the immunotherapy, and the other half is called the control group. The control group will be given the standard therapy. Okay, so let's say both of them get chemotherapy, but then one group gets a placebo and the other group gets the immunotherapy. And then we track these people over time, and you know, we basically figure out how do they respond and do they actually live longer. And so what we're looking at here are survival curves from these clinical research trials. And so for melanoma, what we're looking at here is just we're following these patients kind of from 0 to 18 months after they've begun receiving these treatments. And the blue group, again, is the control group, and the yellow group is the treatment group, the ones that got immunotherapy. And so the point is that the yellow line is far above the blue line, which means that the people who are receiving the immunotherapy are living a lot longer. 18 months after, there's, you know, a much larger fraction of 12 months later, 18 months later, a much larger fraction of them are still alive. Okay? In fact, you know, the scientific way of expressing this is you can look at a hazard ratio of death, which basically says what's your chance of dying if you're in the control group versus the treatment group. And your chance of dying is only 0.4 times what it is in the control group. Okay, so there's more than a 50% gain in survival, in other words. The same is true for leukemia. Same is true for lung cancer. So there's basically for all of these cancer sites, there's an entire medical literature that has pictures exactly like this, okay, which basically tracks kind of these survival curves for people who live longer. Breast cancer is an interesting one in the sense that immunotherapy was first applied to breast cancer. And so for breast cancer, we actually have a much longer follow-up study. We have 10 years worth of data on the effectiveness of these therapies. And so, whereas for the others, because they're all such recent medical innovations, we, you know, usually only have 1 to 2 year of follow-up. But for breast cancer, again, we see like a strong, kind of a strong response, and one that's very persistent, even 10 years later, it's still very active. By the way, feel free to interrupt me at any point in time. We have time, so if you have questions, please jump in. Now, the key problem, and this is where, you know, we as economists or as kind of business, or, you know, you can think of this as a business proposition as well as an interesting economic problem. Here's where we come in. The problem with these immunotherapies, for all their great scientific medical promise, they are extremely expensive. Okay, so for example, the melanoma case that President Carter just went through, basically the current prescription is a cocktail of two drugs, Yervoy and Opdivo. The combination costs $159,000. Okay? And it turns out if you look at all these cancer sites, my circle picture from before, the average cost is at least $50,000. And that's just for the drug. That's without the hospital, that's without the doctors, that's without all the other peripheral expenses that are involved. And some of these are much worse. There's these new therapies called CAR T-cell therapies, which cost $1 million, all medical expenses. And so, you know, basically, that's a lot of money, and that's basically something that a lot of people can barely afford, right? So even if you have health insurance, and even if you're like a Columbia professor or you have a good health insurance system, you're still going to have to pay all the copays for your medical insurance. First of all, you're going to have to pay your medical insurance. Second, you're going to have to pay all the copays. And probably, if you have one of these diseases, you'll hit the out-of-pocket maximum on your health insurance, right? So that out-of-pocket maximum is like $20,000 at least a year. In many plans. Right, so take the Obamacare kind of standard silver plan for a family, for a typical family in America, the combined cost of your out-of-pocket maximum and your actual health insurance would be something like $20,000 a year, which is 30% of your income. So even in the best case scenario where all these costs are covered, where you have health insurance that covers all of this, you're still looking to spend 30% of your budget on these therapies, right? Which is a lot of money. And so kind of that raises the kind of, and by the way, you know, that's if you're lucky and you live in a country that actually reimburses these type of treatments. What this picture shows you is a cross-section of countries and how many of the new immunotherapies these countries have actually improved. And so what you can see is that there's this relationship, this positive relationship between how rich the country is, measured in GDP per capita, and how many of these recent treatments they've actually approved. And so what this picture suggests is that, you know, middle-income countries like Turkey or the Philippines or Brazil, they've just adopted maybe like 10 out of the 40 recent treatments. Now, probably in part because they're so expensive, right? And so we kind of face this dystopian future where on the one hand, we have all this exciting medical progress and all these new kind of therapies that are really promising to raise survival in a very durable and in a very meaningful fashion, but at the same time are unaffordable for the vast majority of the population. And so this conundrum, I think this is a conundrum, this is a big problem we face as society. This conundrum is only going to get worse over time. The reason it's going to get worse is because there's going to be more and more of these therapies. You know, for example, all these immunotherapies, there's this entire pipeline of drugs that are already in the process. Second, the population of the world is aging, and so cancer is something that typically occurs a little bit later in life, so that the incidence of cancer is going to grow. And then finally, the fiscal position of the governments everywhere is worsening. Right? Remember in the United States, Medicare is going to run out of money in 2026. So what are we going to do if on the one hand, the pharmaceutical companies come to the US government and say, look, we have this wonderful drug. It cures cancer with very high likelihood, but it costs, you know, $350,000. What is Medicare going to say? Sorry, you know, we're going to have to say, sorry, we're broke, right? So so this is kind of a problem. So this is, I think, kind of an urgent problem where which is clearly getting worse. So on the one hand, there's kind of a lot of excitement about all this new medical development. At the other hand, we have a very important problem paying for it. And this issue is kind of a generic issue in the following sense. So I've given you this example of immunotherapy, and strictly speaking, the paper I'm discussing is an immunotherapy paper. But this problem applies equally to any life-saving, expensive medical innovation. And there are many other good examples. For example, hepatitis C. It turns out that there's a company, hepatitis C is a disease that if you take one pill, it cures you with probability 90%. Okay, so there's an incredibly effective way. If you don't take the pill, you die. If you take the pill, you're basically healthy. The pill costs $80,000. Okay? So that's a lot of money, again, for a lot of people. Organ transplants. There's tens of thousands of people who are waiting for organ transplants. We've made a lot of medical progress in constructing artificial organs. It costs about $415,000 for an organ transplant. HIV/AIDS drug cocktail in America costs $18,000. Only half of the people who need these drugs actually get them. Severe heart failure, recently, this is a Wall Street Journal article from just a few weeks ago, they've invented a little chip that you can implant in your heart, and it dramatically cuts the incidence of severe heart failure. The little chip costs $30,000. Again, without the cost, the hospital cost, the doctor cost, and so forth. So in general, we have all kinds of targeted therapies. One of the kind of new lines of business where pharma is growing is the so-called orphan drug space, where orphan drugs are drugs for people for where the incidence of the disease is less than fewer than 200,000 people. So it turns out pharmaceutical companies are now kind of developing drugs that are rare, but of course these drugs, again, are very expensive. And you know, another example which is a little more controversial, opioids. America has an enormous opioid addiction problem. People are dying left and right from an overdose. Turns out there's a pretty good opioid substitute treatment, which does save people's lives. It's clinically proven, and again, is expensive. And finally, I think in the future, we're going to see a lot more of these gene and stem cell therapies, molecular repair, regenerative medicine, that ultimately is going to have the promise of keeping us alive for longer, but only if you can pay for it. And these are going to be very expensive treatments. Right? So we're going to have, so a lot of people talk about inequality, income inequality, wealth inequality. We're going to have health inequality in the future. We already have health inequality in this country. We're going to have a lot more of it because there's going to be all this wonderful medical innovation, but a lot of people are not going to be able to pay for it. So what existing financing solutions do we have?
Well, of course we have health insurance, right? We've already talked about health insurance. One issue with health insurance is that they're co-pays. So, you know, the idea is that if you could just go to the doctor all the time, you would overuse health insurance, and therefore, economists like to call this moral hazard. Therefore, we're going to have you make a co-payment of $30 or $40 every time you go to the doctor to discourage your use. Now, these co-pays also apply to any cancer care. You could kind of debate whether that's even a reasonable thing to do. Why should there be a co-pay for cancer care? I'm unlikely to overuse cancer treatment, but that's how it is. And so we've talked about kind of the ruinous out-of-pocket costs that one of these diseases could easily push you into. There's another issue, which is that if you lose your job in America, you also lose your health insurance, because most health insurance is employment-sponsored, employment-provided, employer-provided. And so whenever you get fired, you're basically out of luck. And so all of a sudden, you no longer have any insurance to deal with these issues. And even if you do get new insurance, if you change jobs, now you're this many years older, you face reclassification. Your health insurance may become a lot more expensive than it was before. And then, of course, some of these treatments are not covered. So there's another solution, which is a credit market solution. So this is a simple idea of, why don't you just kind of get a loan, right? If, you know, suppose you get this disease, you don't have money to pay for it. Why don't you just go to the bank and say, I want to borrow $1 million to pay for my CAR T cell therapy? Well, the bank is going to look at you and say, sorry, that's just not going to work, because first of all, if you die, how are you possibly going to pay me back? Second, even if you survive, you know, you're likely to not be as productive as you were before. Your kind of repayment, your kind of debt servicing capacity has deteriorated, right? So, you know, human capital is kind of bad collateral, if you think about it. And so that makes this loan market deficient. And then finally, there's this market for life settlements, which is a bit of a cowboy industry. Heard about this life settlements. So you have these companies, and they will basically buy your life insurance policy from you. And the idea is that they then become the beneficiary when you die. So you designate this life insurance, this life settlement company as your beneficiary, and then even when you die, they receive your death benefit, and in the meantime, they pay your premiums. Okay, so they basically take over your life insurance policy, and they give you a little bit of money in return for that. And then the idea is you could use that money to pay for your cancer. Now, the problem with this solution is that, like I said, it's traditionally been a bit of a cowboy industry. So if your policy is really worth, like, let's say 100, they'd offer you 20 or 30 for your policy, okay? So they buy these policies at deep discounts, which technically just means that you as an individual, you have this valuable asset and they're giving you pennies on the dollar for it, right? And so you're in dire straits, they're taking advantage of the situation and they're just giving you 20 cents on the dollar. Now, this industry has recently become a bit more competitive, but it's kind of a strange industry. And most importantly, they have an incentive for you to die, which is the wrong way around, right? That's not a good incentive. And this industry has actually a very bad track record. So these guys sprung up in the HIV/AIDS epidemic in the 80s, started buying all these policies from AIDS patients. And then, you know, this is kind of, I guess, good news if you have this fairness or kind of bent. All these companies went bankrupt. Why? Because we then invented this potent cocktail for AIDS, HIV, and all these AIDS patients lived much longer than these insurance companies, these life settlement companies thought they would. And so they kind of, these companies ended up getting, taking a big loss. Okay, so suffice to say, these existing solutions are not good. And so here, finally, we come to the idea that I wanted to tell you about. Okay, so the main idea in our paper is that there's actually another solution to pay for this expensive life-saving treatment. And the idea is very simple. This is kind of a net present value. You're all taking finance, right? This is an NPV calculation. So the idea is the following. If you have a life insurance policy, let's say you're 30 years old. You buy life insurance when you're healthy. That life insurance policy is going to be very, very cheap. By the way, you should all buy life insurance. It's kind of one of the best investments you could possibly make. It's a very cheap contract when you're healthy and when you're young. Okay, so your premium is going to be very low. Because why are the premiums going to be so low? Because your death benefit is going to be paid out like 50 years from now when you're 80 and you're going to die. So the net present value, let's say you buy a policy with $1 million death benefit, face value. The net present value today as a 30-year-old of that $1 million 50 years from now is very, very low. It's going to be like $50,000 or something. Okay? So now you buy this policy. The life insurance company values that policy at $50,000. That's how it's on its books. So now the next second or the next year, you get cancer. You're like 31 years old. Now you get cancer and you now have, instead of 50 years to live, you have 3 years to live. Let's think about the economics of what's happening to the life insurance company, to this contract. What's happening is that your death benefit of $1 million, instead of being paid out 50 years from now, it's going to have to be paid out 2 years from now. So that brings that $1 million much closer into the present. And so that dramatically increases the liability to the life insurance company. Not only that, that's the first big effect. That's the biggest effect. It's just the time value of money type. The second big effect is that because you're not going to die like 48 years earlier, that's 48 years of premiums that you're not going to be paying to your life insurance company anymore. So that's the second source of loss to the life insurance company. So what we do in this paper is we actually quantify first of all, if you get cancer, what does that do to the value of your life insurance policy? And then we say, well, what if now all of a sudden there is a solution, immunotherapy, where you're going to, at least with some probability, you're going to be able to push that life expectancy back to 50 years into the future. So think of immunotherapy, or more broadly, about any medical life-saving treatments as a technology that's now available to restore your life expectancy to what it was before you got the disease. And maybe this does not solve the problem for 100% of the cases, but it solves the problem, let's say, for 50% of the cases, which is a big number. So the way to think about this is, you know, the life insurance company has an enormous incentive to make sure that you get this treatment. Because if you don't get this immunotherapy, even though it's available because you cannot afford it, and you do die, they have this massive increase in liability. In other words, they would be willing to pay for your immunotherapy. That is the key idea. That is the key insight. Life insurance companies have a private incentive. It's in their own best interest to pay for life-extending, expensive medical innovation, such as immunotherapy. That is the basic idea in the paper. It's a simple net present value idea. That's it. I've told you everything. We can all go home. Okay? Now, you can quantify this. And we quantify this. So basically, another way of saying what I just said is you could think of immunotherapy as a windfall to the life insurance companies. Why is it a windfall? Well, because they didn't have to pay for it, right? It's the pharma companies that paid for all the R&D to come up with all this new technology. So for them, from the perspective of the life insurance company, basically this technology that now kind of makes people live longer is a pure gain. It's a windfall. So we calculate the value of that windfall. And I'll show you some of these calculations, but the bottom line number is this windfall is $6.8 billion per year. So we can also do the NPV of that. That's a flow number, right? So the stock, the NPV, is something like $250 billion in value, okay, which is an enormous number. Just to put it in perspective, the overall revenues of the life insurance sector are only about $30 billion a year. So this is big relative to the flow revenues. Can I show you these calculations? So now we've understood that immunotherapy, that the life insurance companies essentially benefit from the invention of these medical life-saving technologies. We can basically turn this around and say, well, can we not use all that money, that $6.8 billion that life insurance companies gain, to pay for some of this care, right? Now, that, of course, raises the question, why would these life insurance companies be willing to pay for this in the first place, right? They don't have to. So let's think about that as we go through it, okay? So, but we're going to propose a few financing mechanisms for how we can tap into that $6.8 billion to pay for this cancer care. So that's the basic idea. Any kind of big picture questions, thoughts? Okay, so now I'm going to fill you in on some of the details of this, and I don't want to bore you with too much details and math, although at the end of the day, there's very little high-tech focus going on in this paper. As I said, this is just a simple net present value calculation. So we're going to be thinking about this life insurance contract. And so what's a life insurance contract? It's an annuity, right? You all learned about annuities in your foundations of finance class. It's, you know, basically, you'll be paying a premium until you die, That's and we're going to calculate the NPV of that, discounted back at some interest rate R, and that's it. Now, the one only little difficulty is that you're going to die with some probability P. Okay, that's your mortality rate. And so, you know, you can kind of capture this mortality rate as kind of with this process mu here. The details are not important. So this is the net present value. And what is the net present value from the perspective of the life insurance company? You'll be paying this premium pi as long as you live. That's how much total premium payment in NPV you make. And then they will have to pay you the death benefit, that's the $1 million, when you die. Okay, and that's all this is saying. So now imagine that all of a sudden, this is kind of before immunotherapy gets invented. Now immunotherapy gets invented. And so now all of a sudden, there's a possibility for them to restore your life to what it was before the diagnosis, right? So think of mu D as kind of capturing your likelihood of dying when you have the disease. D stands for the disease. And with some probability, they can actually put you back on the mortality curve for healthy people. That's the mu without the D. So, unfortunately, this doesn't work in 100% of the cases. It only works with some probability. So these immunotherapies, they only work for about 1/3 to 1/2 of the patients. Okay? And it's kind of hard to predict beforehand who it is going to work for. So think of that as like a failure rate of 50%. That's this theta. That's that failure rate of 50%. Okay? And so basically, why would the life insurance... So what is the benefit from these immunotherapies? Well, with some probability, you're not going to survive. We're going to have a gain in your survival, and that means you're going to be paying premiums for longer. And with some probability, and with that same probability, you know, we cannot push back that debt benefit further back into the future. Okay, so these are the two benefits that I mentioned. So then what we do is we basically estimate survival curves for healthy people. We estimate survival curves for people who have a disease, for example, stage 3. Melanoma, estimate the parameters of those mortality models using data from the National Center for Health Statistics, survival rates. It turns out to be very, very good medical data on like the fraction, the number of people who get cancer, where their survival probabilities are. So you have fantastic data in this area. We also look at all the approved immunotherapies currently approved by the FDA in the United States. We look at the cost of these drugs, and then we actually have very good data as well on life insurance coverage. Okay, which is important for our calculation. So here's kind of the main table from the paper. So the first thing we do is we estimate kind of the likelihood that these therapies will work. And like I said, it's about 50%. Okay? So now with that 50%, with that estimate for theta in hand, we can basically calculate these benefits, the benefits to the life insurance company. We can work out what this equation is. This is a simple NPV calculation at the end of the year. Okay, so here's the answer. So the way this table is organized is it looks at the age that you currently are, the age that you are at the time that you get your life insurance policy, and it looks at the age of diagnosis. Okay, so let's say that you're 30 years old and you're healthy and you sign a life insurance contract. And now you're 40 years old and you get diagnosed with cancer. Okay, so then we're gonna look at this cell here. What this cell is saying is that for a policy with a $1 face value, there's a benefit of 40 cents to the life insurance company, okay? Which is an enormous number, if you think about it, okay? So if you have a $1 million face value, the life insurance, what this is saying is the life insurance company would be willing to pay $440,000 for your debt. Okay, that's what that number says. Now, as you know, kind of the later you get diagnosed, obviously the smaller this willingness to pay or this benefit to the life insurance companies becomes, because they're basically, your death is already more imminent. As we die, it's an unavoidable consequence of aging. Our death is becoming closer. So there's only so much more kind of extra gain, so much more restoration of life that we can achieve through immunotherapy. So that's why the benefits go down. And then kind of, the later you buy your policy, the more expensive your policy is going to be. If you buy life insurance when you're 50, it's much more expensive than when you're 30. And so actually the life insurance companies tend to lose more from having you die because they're losing this fat premium. And so actually, you can see holding constant the age of diagnosis, you see how the benefit is actually increasing in the year at which you bought your policy, because simply because the premiums are high. Now, to illustrate how powerful this solution mechanism, this funding mechanism potentially could be, let's take the example of Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter needed Yervoy and Opdivo to treat his stage 4 melanoma. The combination cost $159,000 just for the drugs, right? That's the number you've seen before. So now the question is, what size policy would Jimmy Carter need to have? What size life insurance policy would Jimmy Carter need to have to get you a benefit of $159,000? And the answer is a $369,000 policy, which is not a big policy. I bet you if he has life insurance, he has $1 million+ policy. Okay, in other words, you don't need to be a millionaire, you know, to have these type of policies with a death benefit of $370,000. And that's to pay for the entire cost of the medication. Jimmy Carter probably has Medicare, and so he doesn't need to pay for the entire cost of the medication. He only needs to pay for the out-of-pocket component of that cost. This out-of-pocket component is only $20,000. Let's say, that's your out-of-pocket maximum, plus the cost of your health insurance. So how large would your policy have to be to deliver $20,000 in benefits? It would only have to be $46,000. At least if you bought it when you were 30 and you get diagnosed when you were 40. If you bought it when you're 30 and you get diagnosed when you're 70, the policy would have to have a death benefit of $92,000. The point that I'm making here is that these numbers are eminently reasonable. They're very small numbers. You do not need huge policies for this system to work.
I completely agree that they're not large numbers, but you argue that you're, in the ideal world, you'll have separate insurance for different therapeutic areas. Cancer, obviously,
the different health insurance, you mean?
Correct.
So this is a good thought. I'm going to come back to this thought. This whole idea suggests that we need to change the way we do insurance and how we organize health insurance and life insurance. And I'm going to come back. That's, I think, where your thought is heading. I'm going to come back to that. That's an important part of the implications of this. So, this system is only going to work if people have life insurance, right? Because that's the whole premise is based on people having life insurance contracts. So how many Americans have life insurance? A ton, as it turns out. Of all the financial products, life insurance is probably the most prevalent one. Only 50% of Americans own any stock whatsoever, but something like 65% of Americans own life insurance. Okay, so you can see, you know, it's not only true for old people, it's also true for younger people. So it's true for men, it's true for women. And the average death benefit, the average policy value is actually quite high. This is the average. And just going back to my previous numbers here, you know, really you only need like $100,000 for this to pay for the entire out-of-pocket cost. So the average death benefit is comfortably above those numbers, right? Now, also interestingly, even poorer people have life insurance. You may not have thought that. So it turns out people making under $35,000 in income, nearly 50% of those have life insurance, and their policies are obviously smaller, but they're still kind of large enough for this to work, right? So this is not kind of some sort of solution for the middle class or the upper middle class or rich people, because they are the only ones who have health insurance. This actually works across the income distribution for men and for women and for different ages. So what you can do now is you can kind of extrapolate these benefit calculations that we had in this table here. These were, by the way, for melanoma, for stage 4 melanoma. You can now redo these calculations for every cancer site for which there already exists an approved immunotherapy. And we've gone through those calculations. And so basically, this is kind of like calculating the aggregate benefit across all the 17 cancer sites for all the demographic groups. By demographic groups, I mean age and gender. And then kind of taking into account what fraction of these people actually have life insurance, how large their average policy is, and how frequent these cancers are. Okay? And when you do these calculations, this is what you get. So here's my $6.8 billion number. So basically what we're talking about is 330,000 Americans per year who are getting one of these cancers for which there already exists an approved immunotherapy. The average cost of each one of these is about $50,000, but you can see some of them are $100,000, $200,000. There's even some, you know, extreme treatments like the $1 million one I mentioned that I didn't even include here. Right, so this is kind of the typical cost. So what is the total cost? The total cost is for these people, so the total cost to treat all of these people, these are, remember, people that have life insurance and that have one of these cancers, the total cost for their entire treatment is $10.1 billion. That's how much it would cost to pay for their entire care for these immunotherapy drugs. What is the benefit to the life insurance companies from immunotherapy? It's $6.7 billion. In other words, this benefit is big enough to pay for 67% roughly of the entire cost of the treatment. Now, we don't actually have to cover the entire cost because we have health insurance that covers the bulk of it. All we need to cover is the out-of-pocket cost that the patient has to bear. And so the out-of-pocket cost is about $4 billion. In other words, the benefit to the life insurance companies is 150%. It's 1.5 times the total cost of the patient. So this system is big enough, in other words, to pay for all of the out-of-pocket costs and have 50% left over. Does that make sense? And you can kind of see how it breaks down across the different cancer sites. Lung cancer is the biggest one, for example. So the bottom line is the benefits to life insurers are large, $6.8 billion per year. And so now the question is, how can we use these benefits to finance the war on cancer, right? Which is kind of what the title of the paper is about. Now, this is kind of where it gets tricky and a little hairy. And so you gotta now think about this. Somebody just gave you $6.8 billion. That's wonderful. Why would you want to give any of it away? Why would you, as a life insurance industry, say, you know, guess what? We'll share some of it and we'll pay for cancer care. You don't have to. Nobody's forcing you to. And so this becomes a bargaining game between the consumer, the patient, the life insurance policyholder, you, me, and the life insurance industry who sold us these contracts. And so now you could think about, you know, different situations where there's different bargaining power. So in the extreme situation where the consumer has all the bargaining power, we could basically go to our life insurance company and say, you got to pay for the treatment. I have this cancer. I can't pay for it. You need to pay for it. Even if they pay for all of it, for all of your out-of-pocket cost, they'd still have $2 billion left over per year. Okay, so they'd still profit from this. It'd be in their private best interest to pay for this. They'd still have $2 billion left over. Now you may say that's an unrealistic scenario. Well, that depends on competition, right? So maybe in today's environment that's unrealistic, but maybe what if one of you, after seeing this talk, starts a life insurance company and starts offering this product in the marketplace and starts undercutting all the existing life insurance companies and gaining market share? What's the chance that the other life insurance companies would have to follow suit and also start to compete with you in this dimension? Right, so this idea that the consumer has all the bargaining power could be the outcome of a, might take some time, but the outcome of a competitive process where just life insurance companies did not realize this, now they do, after you started your business, and you know, everybody else has to follow suit. The alternative situation is the consumer has zero bargaining power, the life insurance companies have all the bargaining power. They don't want to share. So what could they do? There's something that would cost them almost no money and would still be effective. It would not be a full solution, would not be a great solution for patients, but it would be progress. The first thing they could easily do is they could offer everybody with immunotherapy a loan. Okay? And they would basically say, look, you have valuable collateral. Your collateral is your life insurance, your death benefit, is your life insurance policy. And actually, the only person who could, who has access to that collateral is your life insurance company. It'd be much harder to go to the bank and borrow against your life insurance policy. But your life insurance company could easily give you a loan with the collateral being your life insurance policy. If you cannot pay back the loan, no problem, your life insurance policy is gone. That's the collateral. So basically, they could allow you to borrow the money you need to pay for your therapy. And then, you know, if you cannot pay back, you know, that just kind of, they're going to take that money out of your policy. It's not ideal. Why is it not ideal? Well, because if you cannot pay back, you no longer have life insurance. Maybe the life insurance for your kids, and the life insurance is gone now. But at least you got to pay for your immunotherapy. So it's not ideal for the consumer, but, you know, we're analyzing the situation where the consumer has no bargaining power. So think of this as an efficient credit market solution. It's a bit like these life loans that we were talking about, but it's a much better version of it. The second possibility they could do is they could say, look,
here's your money from your debt benefit. I'm going to give it to you now. And I'm going to subtract it from your debt benefit. So you have $1 million policy. You need $500,000 to pay for the care. Here's $500,000. You now have $500,000 debt benefit. Okay, so they give you some of the money early. And you can think of this as an efficient life settlement solution. Instead of involving these life settlement cowboy companies, you know, they're going to do that in-house. The life insurance company will do this in-house. And at least they don't have these screwed up incentives where they want you to die as soon as possible. In fact, they have the opposite incentive to keep you alive. So these would be very cheap, very simple solutions. And probably the simplest way of implementing our idea would be through these. You could imagine intermediate solutions where, you know, for example, you get a loan and you only have to repay the loan if the therapy succeeds. Or they could subsidize your interest rate on this loan. Okay, so they could pool the idiosyncratic treatment risk. So there'd be some things in between. So that's kind of, and then there's basically, that's basically the idea. Now I want to point out a couple of important implications of this idea. So, and this kind of gets me to the last part of the talk. So one thing is that this idea has interesting, it sets in motion an interesting virtuous cycle. And so here's the virtuous cycle. So whatever kind of in whatever bargaining situation, imagine that patients gain more access to immunotherapies. They now live longer, right? Because they now have access to treatment. Once they live longer, life insurance becomes actually cheaper. This is kind of mind-blowing. The life insurance company gives you something extra that they didn't give you before. They offer to pay for some of your treatment. So they're giving you an extra feature in the product. Think of it as they're bundling two products. They're bundling a regular life insurance contract with this catastrophic insurance contract. And the bundle costs less than the sum of the parts. In finance, we would say this violates some sort of no arbitrage relationship or something like that. Okay, but it's true. And the reason it's true is because it reduces your, it improves your longevity. It reduces your mortality. So as a result, life insurance becomes cheaper, not more expensive. If life insurance becomes cheaper, more people buy it. Not just for the immunotherapy benefit, but just in general, because it's good to have life insurance for your kids when you die. So the overall population becomes better insured, which is a positive thing. So now more people will actually buy these pharmaceutical company drugs for immunotherapy. That's going to generate more profits for the pharma companies. These profits are going to fund additional development, R&D, in additional immunotherapy products, possibly additionally subsidized by life insurance companies. These additional products are going to lead to additional survival gains, which is going to make life insurance even cheaper and even more beneficial. And so this circle starts to kind of feed on itself in a positive way. Okay, so normally we think zero-sum economics. This is win-win-win economics. Everybody benefits. There's no losers from this. It's a free lunch. How appropriate. It is literally a free lunch. There are very few free lunches in the world. This is one of them. Okay? Appropriately, you all had free lunch, so it's only appropriate that I'm showing you an example of a free lunch. Now we come to your question. Separation between health and life insurance industry is inefficient. Why is this? Well, suppose you would merge life insurance and health insurance companies. The merged company would maximize the sum of profits, right? That's what a merger does. It maximizes the sum of the two profits. And once you merge them, you would internalize the benefits that higher health insurance coverage has on access to life-extending treatment. If you have better, if your out-of-pocket maximum is much lower, for example, now you're going to be able to afford these therapies. You're going to get these therapies, and you're going to live longer. And so there's a benefit from, there's basically cross-subsidization, if you like, between health and life insurance. And right now, there is no internalization of these benefits because these two industries are completely separated from each other. Okay, so our insight is that a combination policy that offers life insurance with critical illness insurance may actually be cheaper than life insurance without critical illness. That's kind of my free lunch idea. Okay? Now, it turns out some of this already exists in Asia. In Hong Kong, for example, the large insurance company, French insurance company, AXA, offers this product called Health Vital 2 Major Illness Plan, which is a life insurance contract which pays the death benefit if you have a disease which is on a list of diseases, and of course cancer is on that list. Okay, so kind of that's in some sense already a combination policy. It's not an ideal one, but it's kind of something that goes in that direction. So those are kind of two important long-term implications, this virtuous cycle, and then this idea that in the long run, this separation of health and life insurance industries may not be sustainable. First of all, it may not be optimal, and second, it might not even be sustainable once somebody combines these products and starts offering these combination insurance products. This whole idea that I've talked about also works in a slightly different context, and that context is old age and Alzheimer's. So again, as people get older, more and more people get Alzheimer's and eventually need to go to a nursing home. Nursing homes are extremely expensive. For those of you who are not from the United States, a semi-private room in a private nursing home facility costs somewhere between $80,000 and $120,000 a year, out of pocket. Nearly all Americans are unprepared to pay for this. And as we live longer, we're gonna live more years, but we're probably also gonna live more years in a nursing home because of cognitive decline. If we all turn 115, probably in the last 15 years, we're all gonna have dementia, or with very high likelihood. So you can buy insurance against this, long-term care insurance. So you see where this is gonna go. So long-term care insurance companies would have an incentive to keep you out of the nursing home, just like life insurance companies have an incentive to keep you alive. And so long-term care insurance companies would have an incentive to pay for drugs that slow the onset of Alzheimer's. Now, I've met a Columbia medical school professor who just joined from Harvard a few months ago, a fellow Belgian, as it turns out. And his specialty is Alzheimer's, and he told me that Alzheimer's, there's major breakthroughs in Alzheimer's research which actually also use the immune system to fight Alzheimer's. And we're on the verge of a major breakthrough in this field as well. So the idea, but again, the drugs are expensive, the development of the drugs is very expensive. So again, you can imagine long-term care insurance industry as a source of funding both for the patient and for the pharmaceutical companies in principle to develop these drugs.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Is there a way to quantify, like, the drugs are expensive, the treatments are expensive, like, is that profit that the medical company is making, or is that the actual cost of the treatment?
So this is a good question, and in a way, so I'm making a philosophical decision to stay away from the debate on drug pricing, because in a way, it's not really relevant for my idea. So my view on this, is that this might be a view that's not shared with, that many of you may not share, but, and again, there's a limit to this argument, okay? But if I can save somebody's life by giving them a pill that costs $80,000, I've probably transferred a ton of wealth to them. And you may not agree with this. You may say that's too expensive, the drug companies are taking advantage of this poor person who's gonna die if he can. We can afford $80,000. Well, that's why we're having this discussion. How are we going to pay for it? And yes, one funding mechanism is to reduce the price of drugs. But there is research that shows if pharmaceutical companies are less profitable, they invest less in R&D. And so now this whole virtuous cycle of innovation and medical innovation may come to a grinding halt. Don't forget that American pharmaceutical companies are paying for the world's R&D. You know, my fellow friends from Europe in the room, we are benefiting from the American pharmaceutical companies that are inventing for immunotherapies for us. Okay? It's a fact of life. These are extremely expensive, very uncertain prospects. And so is this a fair profit? I don't know. That's almost a philosophical debate.
But I'm saying, like, another angle of efficiency here would be for the life insurers to merge with the drug companies.
Mm-hmm. Right. Absolutely.
And then it's all in-house.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And our idea suggests that. Yes. Okay, so I'm going to stop here because I've spoken for way too long. But if you want to read more about this, there's kind of some questions about why isn't this already happening? What are the frictions?
what versions of this exist. We can post these slides, I guess, on the website, and you can read about it. But instead, I want to wrap up. I'll give you a bit of chance to talk if you want to. So basically, what we showed is that these life-extending medical innovations, such as immunotherapy, create large benefits to life insurance. I think that's a new insight. We quantify these benefits. They're about $6.8 billion per year, which is large relative to life insurance products, and also very large relative to the cost of the patient, the out-of-pocket cost of the patient. Now, this is a value creation that can help finance the high cost of expensive life-extending treatments. How exactly you design the financing depends on the relative bargaining power of life insurers and consumers. And if you implement it, this could activate a virtuous cycle of cheaper life insurance, better coverage against risk of death, and more life-extending medical innovation, which I think is an exciting prospect. And then I think life-extending medical innovation may well have to redraw the boundaries between life and health insurance in the future. These are industries that have traditionally developed very separately. You know, even at Columbia University, my benefits, you guys probably, students probably also get benefits from Columbia. My life insurance company through Columbia is Aetna. My health insurance company is United. What's going on? Why are we not integrating this? Even employers like Columbia could in-house already accomplish this synergy. Okay, so this is what I wanted to share with you. I hope you thought it was interesting, and I'd be happy to take any questions that you may have.